Hi, everybody. Welcome to my homestead and welcome to my channel. As you can see, we're with Jen Stevens again. She's had some more insights and realizations come through since the last video that we did. That video, if you missed it, you should go back and watch it. It was wildly popular. It was really good. There were a lot of like really interesting things to think about as we're approaching this next general conference. And it's Monday, so general conference is this week, starting on Saturday. I know a lot of people are excited for that. We've had so much conversation and discussion since this last general conference. It's just things are wild. And I have like a video I want to do today with like developments over the weekend in Israel. So things are just like really ramping up. Before we get into things, I do want to do a quick thing here. I'm going to share my screen. Just give a little update on the Book of Mormon Sharing Challenge. So we're getting really, really super close and within striking distance of 5,000 copies of the Book of Mormon shared. We're at 4,925. And the number of people sharing has gone up. Not as much as I would like, but all of you out there, please just take part in this because it's just awesome. Let's just see what we can do. You know, we have the power of the internet. I'm willing to track all of it. And that's kind of like, I think the key to like putting together this big effort, and we can probably do some amazing things. So number of shares, please, let's try and get that up into the thousands. When you share your updates with me, do hashtag flood. That way it's easy for me to find. You can put it in the comments or you can send it to me by email. Those are the two preferred methods. So, but we're looking pretty good. So good job, everybody. So, all right. So just as a quick recap, Jen, we were talking last time, and we've been talking a lot about Palm Sunday. I think since that interview, the church on their website, like when you go to the 2023 General Conference, like it's not up yet, but they have that portion ready and it has a picture of Palm Sunday. You go to the church, the main page right now, the banner that it has on there for a General Conference is Palm Sunday. So it seems like it's a big deal. And so you've come across some more things to think about.
I have, yes. Right? Yes. And I'm really excited because the whole idea of Palm Sunday and thinking about Holy Week and celebrating Holy Week, that's always been something really special in our family. It's been a really interesting, the last 2 weeks have been, like you said, just pretty wild. I've discovered a lot of new things. So I didn't think that I would be back on here so soon, but I think that this is going to get you guys really excited for General Conference 2023, because I had some inklings of things. It wasn't until I really sat down and started writing it out that so much more just came together, and it was really pretty shocking to me. And so I'm excited to walk you through it. So just to remind you guys, we talked about holy day stacking in the last video. And what I mean when I say holy day stacking is it's when multiple anniversaries of similarly themed scriptural events all land on the same day. So it's like a literal memorial in time telling us something. And we know that history repeats. So when we see these patterns, and I think this holy day stacking is when we see it and we hear the prophet saying, this is a hinge point. It can tell us something about the days that we're living in, and it can tell us something about the days that are coming. And we know that we are preparing and getting ready for the second coming, and there's hastening. So I have been experiencing this hastening, and I can't wait to share what I found. So just a really quick review. Here, let me pull up my presentation here.
Yeah, and I know a lot of people in their personal lives, they've felt a hastening. There's been a number of people that I've talked to that have come back to activity in the church, and just like, you know, doing this miracle series of videos where people are reporting just different miracles that seem to indicate a hastening, both with family that are living, family that are dead, and other things. So yeah,
it's definitely incredible. And that's what's been for me the most exciting part about this, is it's so much more than just, oh, these dates and these coincidences and the facts. It's the experience of it. And you know how those spiritual things are a lot of times hard to describe, but it's been really interesting. And I know in kind of my circle, I've had a lot of people tell me about just really interesting things that they've been experiencing. So let's do a quick review If you watch the April 2023 General Conference special timing video, you might remember our discussion about holy day stacking. And so during the General Conference 2020, which marked the 200th anniversary of the Restoration, we celebrated a unique stacking of other significant anniversaries, such as Shabbat Haggadah, which is the start of Passover, Nisan 10, and Palm Sunday. And this parallel stacking is also evident, was also evident on the day of the Kirtland Temple dedication. And that was a time that opened the door to Pentecostal blessings and miracles for the saints. It's really wonderful time. And it's really kind of neat that General Conference 2023 has the same rare holy day stacking. And then at the same time, right now, we have President Nelson promising the greatest miracles in our coming days. So I think as we learn these things, it can really boost our faith as to what the prophet is saying and what the prophets in the past have said. And we kind of combine it all together in the days of the fulfillment of all things, when all things become one in Jesus. And so if you have not watched that April 2023 General Conference special timing video, you can watch it here on Christian Homestead, or you can also go to my channel, which is Christian Fire Poppy, and you can watch that first one. That will help this one.
And the link for her channel, it's going to be in the description below. It's also, if you just go to the homepage, she's under my featured channels.
All right. Well, since this is a continuation, we're talking about holy days, holy things. This topic even more has a lot more temple events and themes. So Jared, are you up for one more opening prayer?
I am.
Yep. Okay. Right.
I guess I'll say it this time.
Sure.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we're good for this day. Thankful that we get to talk together again, me and Jen. And we pray that the Spirit will be with us and just help everybody listening to prepare and be prepared by the Spirit for this upcoming General Conference. We're all very excited for it. We pray that we'll have eyes to see, ears to hear, and just be sufficiently spiritually prepared. And we pray for any inspiration and things that we can pull out of this this presentation that'll help us. And we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. All right. So throughout history, there have been pivotal hinge point events that have opened the way to hastening events, with Shabbat Haggadah leading to the Passover and deliverance, and Palm Sunday was a hinge point in time, eventually leading to the resurrection. The Kirtland Temple dedication was a hinge point leading to Pentecostal blessings and the Savior appearing in the temple. And General Conference 2020, with the 2023 parallel stacking, may just be a hinge point leading to these same types of things, eventually culminating in the second coming. Jared, I really did like how in your Palm Sunday Liahona video that you pointed out how in the Liahona in April that these themes are already showing up. And it's kind of cool because it also opens with a parallel to the General Conference 2020 to hear him. So that's the very first thing that's in there. And this was the challenge that began 40 days before that 2020 General Conference. So there's a lot of that Palm Sunday emphasis. And what I'm going to show you next, so this new more holy day stacking that I found. This actually is another emphasis that shows up in the April Liahona. So I'll also be showing you three different examples of where this theme is showing up as well. So that was pretty exciting to see. So this process of discovering this new holy day stacking theme began with a simple question that I had. And it was, why is President Nelson referring to both the General Conference 2020 anniversary and the Rome Temple dedication as hinge points in history? So it made sense to talk about one or the other as being a hinge point. For temple dedication in 2019, point, and a year later also refer to 2020 200th anniversary as a hinge point in time. And so I got to think, day stacking for that hinge point day, there is some good solid holiday stacking on the dedication day, and sure enough there was. So we're gonna get into that. So it really just, when I started putting it together, it just really kind of blew me away. And to top it all off, I actually experienced a direct miracle holy day, on the exact day that I started compiling this and writing this all down. and all at the very end, but
All
it's
right.
very exciting times. So let's go ahead.
And really quick, I just want to point out, because I doubt that it's in this presentation, but a long time ago, I don't know how long, but there was one point where I was like studying this whole concept of hinge point. I wanted to see, you know, had it been said in past journal conferences, and I did a search other places, and there was, I think it was an Ensign at the time, an Ensign article where there was a general authority. I don't remember the name, but he actually used the term hinge point to talk about the Kirtland Temple. So
Really? Oh, I didn't
yes.
know. Okay.
Yeah. And so it makes me wonder if, like, kind of like behind the scenes, as they talk about, as like they're meeting together, general authorities meeting together, if they kind of like, if that's like a term, you know, kind of like a word that they use to discuss these like really important times. Like,
yeah.
It's not just like a casual
yeah.
word. It actually like really means something like we think it does.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And that could be. I do kind of wonder what, you know, if only we can know the full extent, because you know that the prophet and apostles know a lot more than they directly tell us. So anyway, so this holy day stacking, before we get into it, I really want to hit on the why. I feel like this last week, it really came all together for how important and why this is important. So Jared, like everything you track and take note of on your channel, why do you do it? Like all
Why
the
do I
things
take
that you're...
what? Sorry, I got some noise in the background. Why do I track different things on my channel?
Yeah, all the things that you're tracking. Why do you do it?
Well, I feel like all the like taking note and kind of plotting all these different events, words, things like that, it helps us get a sense for where we are in the timeline, so to speak, how close the second coming is, really.
Right. Yeah, it could tell us a lot of these things. And some of these things, like I love how you track so many different things, and we as the viewers can kind of decide for ourselves. Does this mean anything? Yes, no. It's kind of like you sift through everything, and anything that has a possibility, you throw out there for us. And then we get that adventure of kind of sifting through it. But George Q. Cannon has a really great quote. He says, "The greatest events that have been spoken of by all the holy prophets will come along so naturally as the consequences of certain causes, that unless our eyes are enlightened by the Spirit of God and the Spirit of Revelation rests upon us, we will fail to see that these are the events predicted by the holy prophets." So that to me is a really great why to be looking for these things. And then also we know that President Nelson has said, "In coming days, we will see the greatest manifestations of the Savior's power that the world has ever seen. Between now and the time he returns with power and great glory, he will bestow countless privileges, blessings, and miracles upon the faithful." So privileges, what might these privileges be? Well, Jesus had something to say to his disciples about their privileges. And he said, "But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For verily I say unto you that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye hear and have not heard them." So we don't have our scriptural eyes and ears open wide and watching, we're going to miss out. So it's kind of cool because prophets since the beginning of time have wanted to experience the wonders of the last days. And we know that we're living in the last days. So,
and isn't that what the current, what's it called? Come follow me. Like, isn't that what the last lesson was? It was called, because like, okay, hold on, honey, your lesson that you gave in Relief Society, wasn't it called Eyes to See and Ears to Hear? Anyway, she said it was basically based on that. And I just wonder if like the
awesome.
Timing of that
awesome.
Has to do with this upcoming general conference.
Well,
Anyway,
the timing is key. It's all about the timing.
Yeah.
That's what this is all about. So definitely. So I also want to say that just my favorite part of that last video we did, Jared, was when I mentioned that, oh, like, if we got the new hymn book, that would be pretty fitting for a Kirtland Temple Pentecost event. And then you revealed, I had no idea that we were going to be hearing from the brand new worldwide Tabernacle Choir for the first time at this general conference. And I had no idea that that was happening, but that is like even more perfect. That's so great.
Yeah.
In Jesus' day, the tongues of fire were manifest, the disciples speaking and prophesying in a multitude of languages. And now we'll get to hear for the first time ever at this time the new global Tabernacle Choir, So we hear the church singing praises to God, each man in their own tongue. That kind of has this real Pentecost feel to it. And you know, normally that change would have just passed by and I wouldn't have thought much about it. But in the, I think in context of the dates and the timing and the holiday stacking, that's actually pretty awesome to me now, how that it's being introduced on this particular day. So, and maybe some of these things, you know, you feel like, oh, you know, that's just something small, that's not a big deal. But the question is, like, does the prophet have a grand vision for these changes that need to happen in this moment of time? So let's see what President Nelson has to say about this. So
Can I say
in
something? Sorry,
November.
really quick. Sorry, I don't mean to keep interrupting, but I just keep having like these
No,
thoughts.
go for it. Yeah, I love your comments.
I've never really thought about this before, comparing, well, just General Conference in general to kind of like Pentecostal type thing, because you have large group of people gathered together and the need to communicate in other languages. And I wonder, you know, we know that there's interpreters, but I wonder if even those interpreters, even though they may be really good, like if they have like that gift of speaking in tongues, in other words, the spirit helping them more smoothly translate what's being said.
Definitely. Definitely. I
Because,
think, you know, just like missionaries,
yeah,
right?
I'll
They get
tell
that
you
extra
what,
boost.
whenever I had to translate on my mission, because I was in a Spanish speaking mission, because we had, there was a mix of people that were Spanish speaking, but we also had a lot of English speakers. It drove me crazy because it was so hard to do, to like try and like in real time communicate what somebody is saying. And so
Yes. Yeah.
I know that they probably have like a printout already in the language, but like they still, I think they probably still have to listen for any like impromptu things if there's any changes. So anyway, I was just thinking about how this idea of like the gift of tongues being present at General Conference with these translators, that it's just, that's just an interesting idea.
Yeah, and I think a lot of times, you know, these miracles and these Pentecostal things that I'm talking about, it sometimes they can be these really amazing, obvious, fantastical miracles, and other times they're more subtle. And anyway, so I think it helps to kind of point them out and gives us something to think about and to be grateful for. And so it's kind of cool because in November the church announced that the Tabernacle Choir at Temple Square was going to take steps to become more of a worldwide choir, in order to better reflect the worldwide membership of the church. So we have music and the spoken word will now include foreign language versions. The choir will travel more often and visit more countries, and singers from Mexico, Central America, South America, West Africa, the Philippines, and Asia will be added to sing with the choir during General Conference this April. And then I really like how President Nelson stated this. He shared his vision for the choir, and he said, "The church will continue to grow. It will fill the world. It will continue to bless more and more nations, tongues, and people," said President Nelson. "The Lord is hastening his work in the promised global gathering of Israel. You can be sure that the Tabernacle Choir, orchestra, and bells at Temple Square will be a pivotal part of that era." So listening to his like language, this sounds like this is a real, you know, fulfilling of these special times that we're embarking on, this really amazing time. And the Tabernacle Choir is a part of that. So, anyways, and let's go ahead and take a look at. So, there's even more evidence that this Palm Sunday excitement is what we think it is. So, President Nelson, who referred to two separate events as being hinge points, he calls General Conference 2020 the hinge point, but then he also calls the dedication of the Rome Temple a hinge point in history. Now, this theme, so this stacking has a really, really nice theme. And this theme revolves around temple imagery and anointing. So, in my mind, our other stacking was kind of about these hinge points and the door imagery. And this seems to be about days of holy anointing of oil that happened right before that grease the hinges. And the other one, we talked about the eight doors of Christ. So we have these events that are hinge points. And so now we have these holy anointings that are kind of oiling or preparing the way before these hinge point events. So before we dive in, I just want to hit on one other reason for why does it matter once more, because I think this is really important. So it's actually fascinating, discovered that holy days and temple ordinances have something very important in common, Zicharon. So We see this word in scriptures when describing holy days and temple activities. So the Hebrew word zikaron translates into the English word memorial. So memorial or zikaron is an act of covenant remembrance. So we remember God, and God remembers his promises to us. And it's a really powerful tool for boosting faith that God gives us to call down the priesthood powers of heaven to earth. So to the Jews, zikaron or memorial, as it's translated, means a lot more than merely just cognitively remembering. For instance, Jews, when they celebrate the holy days of Passover, they regard themselves as being actively and personally brought out of Egypt themselves. It's almost like a role play. It's like they relive it in a sense and the experience of their ancestors, and they trust in present and future deliverance. So through that ritual Passover meal, God's saving deed is not only recalled, but it's also relived. And then as Christians, the Last Supper or sacrament replaced that Passover meal, but serves a similar function, right? So every week we remember, we relive, and we renew what Jesus did on the night of the Last Supper, on the cross, and in Gethsemane, applying it to our lives to always remember him, this idea of renewal. So this type of memorial remembrance, renewal, or scriptural zikaron allows us as individuals to feel like active participants, strengthening our faith so that these, as we read about these larger than life, maybe hard to believe blessings of historical events, can then become authentic and obtainable for us in the present. And that's pretty awesome. So just like the sacrament, when we go to the temple, we place ourselves in the position of an active participant as if we were the person in that certain place of time. And I think the true essence of holy days and temple activity is this zikaron, this ordinance-centered memorial. So in light of this zikaron idea and the word memorial that seems to be included in scriptures surrounding holy days, when the Lord gives holy days, when the Lord is talking about the temple, it actually makes sense that God would create these literal memorials in time of holy day stacking to honor and to self-testify as to how these covenant blessings are available to all generations throughout time and history. And it's pretty cool because if you look at the scriptures, there's a lot of examples that kind of show this. So we see in Leviticus 23, 24, a reference to the holy day of Feast of Trumpets as the memorial. So it says it's a memorial of blowing of trumpets and holy convocation. And then in Exodus 12, 14, God says of the annual Passover, and this day shall be unto you for a memorial. It's also used when they talk about the holy day of Purim and other days. And I also found it used many, many dozens of times in regard to many different temple activities. It's also used in reference to Mary of Bethany anointing Christ with expensive spikenard, and that's going to be a part of our holy day stacking, and we'll get into that more soon. But the word memorial can be found. So I found that it can be found 32 times in scripture when I looked it up, and somewhere around 95% of the time, it's referring to temple activities, holy days, and then also when Mary Bethany anointed Christ's head and feet. So anyway, so you'll see this memorial theme show up for each one of our stacked holy days. So it's all about the timing. And the timing is important because I think these hinge points in history are, you know, self-evident testimonials to the fact that God blesses his covenant children equally throughout all time in history. So it's a huge testimony builder, this memorial time. And I think that it can help to boost our faith and for, as we enter into like more intense seasons of change and hastening, that, you know, usually these hastening times present increased challenges in the world, chaos in the world. But it's also this monument that God is saying he will not forget his covenant people. So despite the challenges, God is going to bless us with increased blessings and help for all of his faith-filled disciples. So no matter how hopeless and crazy things get, that we have these promises to hold on to, and we can count on that. So anyway, so let's go ahead and kind of dig into what we're looking at here. Okay, so this new stacking of holy days that I'm going to show you are preparatory events that occurred just prior to Shabbat Haggadol, which was the beginning of Passover, just prior to Palm Sunday, so the Kirtland Temple dedication, and then just prior to General Conference 2020. So they all share the same themes and dates once again. And again, I just have to say, you know, go to Christian Fire Poppy and watch the other video if you haven't, or here. On Christian Homestead and watch that April 2023 General Conference special timing video. But otherwise, let's take a look at this second witness in time of Holy Day Stacking. So we have this Holy Day Stacking has to do with Nisan 9. So this is right before Nisan 10. Our other stacking was all about Nisan 10. This is about Nisan 9. So it's events that happen right before. So Parshat Pekudei place in the month of Adar, but it's interesting because it celebrates events that originally, so if you go to the scriptures that you're supposed to read on that day, that celebration, the actual events, the original events occurred right before Shabbat Haggadol from Nisan 1 to Nisan 9. And then we have the Mary of Bethany anointing Jesus, and that was on Nisan 9, the day before Palm Sunday. And that is one of those few moments in time where it's specified in scripture on what day. And then we have the Rome Temple dedication, which was right before General Conference 2020, and that occurred on Parashat Pekudei. So all of these events are preparatory. So preparatory to the hinge point events, and they embody temple-themed gifts of the heart being given and holy anointings at the onset of a hastening in history. So in Moses' day, Parashat Pekudei is a time when all the people contributed what they could to the completion of the tabernacle, followed the anointing of oil of the tabernacle. There, Aaron, Moses anoints everything inside the tabernacle. He anoints Aaron, he anoints his sons, and this was the preparation right before Aaron puts up his hands to all the people and the presence of the Lord comes into the tabernacle. And then in Jesus's day, Mary of Bethany anoints Jesus right before Sunday, when all the people raise their palms, hailing Christ as king before the burial and resurrection events. And then in Joseph Smith's day, all the saints actually washed and anointed their feet. That was actually the first action that they all took prior to the Kirtland Temple dedication. And the dedication
I had no idea about that. I had absolutely no idea about that.
That's one of those things that I just discovered this week. So as I started really researching and getting in the details, it was astonishing. And it's actually kind of cool because some accounts say that this dedication was an 8-hour event. Others claim it was a 24-hour event. But either way, this spanned Nisan 9 and 10. So you have this overlap between our other holy day stacking and this. And we know that Hebrew days, they always begin in the evening. So that's why kind of overlap with Nisan 9 and 10. And then this anointing, it leads into a Pentecostal offering leading to the Savior appearing in the temple 7 days later on Easter Sunday. And then we have in our day, the Rome Temple is dedicated, and this is a place anointings, which is right before General Conference 2020, where we all lift our hands and do the Hosanna shout, which eventually will lead us in the second coming. So that's just kind of a quick overview of some of those things. And then we'll get into kind of the details and the evidence. So I want to just start out by talking about the Kirtland Temple dedication and just touch on it lightly because we went over another video. But we'll use this period in time to kind of introduce these new repeating themes. So there's so many similarities, so many similar themes. So also take a look at some of the blessings that are still being poured out today. So we know that these blessings from the Kirtland Temple are still occurring. And this day is particularly interesting because the dedication, just because of that overlap in both days. So that's why we're covering it in both spots. So let's look at the repeating themes of the Hebrew calendar on Nisan 9. So this was a Nisan 9 and 10 event that happened to be Palm Sunday and Shabbat Haggadol as well. They did that dedication. And the first thing that happens before the hinge point event is that holy anointing with oil. So we have that theme. And then the first thing that all attending the Kirtland Temple that they all did was to wash their feet and anoint their feet. And this anointing leads to the completion, the consecration, and dedication of the temple. And then eventually Christ appears, and this is in the very first ever modern temple. So that's a big pinch point in time. And then there's also a theme that I see come up, and that it's a very inclusive theme. It's an inclusive, including men and women. And Lydia Knight, my hero, is a great example. And this time, she experiences the Pentecostal outpouring for a second time at this event. And then there's also a theme of sacrifice and a lot of money being spent. All the saints sacrifice what they can for the Kirtland Temple dedication. And then obviously there's these temple themes that come out, and also this idea of preparation for Jesus coming to his temple. So whether it's in Moses' day, the presence of the Lord, in our day, the second coming, or the Kirtland Temple, he came, you know, Jesus coming to the temple. And then really quick, I just wanted to kind of list and remind you guys these amazing blessings. So these are 7 of the 13 listed blessings. I looked up the Covenant Student Manual, and there are 13 blessings that were listed as far as blessings from the temple, and they're still being fulfilled in our day. So we have, move this really quick, that his servants could go forth armed with power and protected by the angels to spread the gospel to the ends of the earth, that he would establish his people forever against all the enemies who fight against them, that the powers of Pentecost would come upon them, that the servants of God would have the power of the covenant and bear testimony of it throughout the world, that the servants of God would be delivered from the calamity of the wicked and the judgments, that the Lord would have mercy on the nations of the earth, softening their hearts to prepare them for the gospel message, and that the stakes of Zion would be appointed so the gathering might roll forth. And, you know, it's pretty interesting. There are a lot of interesting parallels as well to Pentecost, because, you know, some people that were there experienced these really amazing things. Others said, well, I didn't really, you know, experience that much. So it's kind of, I think it varies based on the individual. And so that's kind of something to think about. How are we preparing? Are we preparing to have those experiences ourselves as we gather and we're looking for these things? Just let me head to, let's see. All right.
It's interesting to note that for like when the Kirtland Temple was dedicated and people were having that Pentecostal experience, you know, after washing and anointing and stuff and going to the temple, it's not like Christ necessarily appeared right then and there for everybody to see, right? And so as we think about like these other hinge points, more recent times, like the April 2020 General Conference, for all we know, you know, that was like the corresponding thing to the dedication of the Kirtland Temple, where we all did a big group thing. We did a Hosanna shout. And for all we know, Christ has been active here on the earth somewhere, probably meeting with the prophet or who knows? Like, we're not going to know until it's all said and done. But
And everybody kind of has these different, you know, we're all experiencing things at different rates and different times. And who knows, like, what experiences everybody's having. But I have a feeling that as a whole, more people are having more experiences, and that's going to be happening more and more frequently as time goes on. But so looking at kind of these themes, so we talked about the Kirtland Temple, and you see these themes play out on Moses' day, we have Parshat Pekudei, in a jar, but it's remembering the Nisan 1-9 events. And we can see that it lists those specific days in Exodus 40 and Leviticus 9. And then that theme of it being right before Nisan 10. So right before the Shabbat Haggadah Passover, or the hinge point, there's the anointing with oil. And then the completion of the tabernacle. So Pekudei is all about completing the tabernacle and preparing it for the presence of the Lord. And then there's also a theme of women holding wisdom and spiritual intuition. And we'll get into that. You can see that money is spent. That is listed specifically. There's the temple theme. And then going to Mary anointing Jesus. You know, in John 12:1, it says, then Jesus 6 days before the Passover came to Bethany, speaking that Nisan 9. And then right before Palm Sunday, so we have the hinge point, we have the anointing with oil, we have the completion of Christ's life, and then we have the theme of a certain woman, Mary, holding wisdom and spiritual intuition. So she knows, she recognizes that this burial and resurrection is coming. And then also the theme of She spends a lot of money on that spike nerd, and Judas complains that it's too much, that it could be for the poor. And again, this her anointing, this is a big temple theme. And then in our day, we have the Rome Temple dedication. And that happened on March 9th, 2019. So that was on Parashat Pekadeh. So at that same time, the Jews were celebrating those Nisan 1 to 9 events and reading those scriptures. You have President Nelson arriving in Rome. And then on Sunday, March 10th, he dedicates the temple. And so this was right before General Conference 2020. And he's telling us this is a hinge point event. We have this kind of anointing with oil is very much a temple activity. And then we have the, you know, the completion of the Rome Temple and the name of President Nelson. And I really like how President Nelson, to me, I always felt like he was going to be this great prophet that had a real understanding and a soft heart for women, because he has 9 daughters. So in my family, I have 4 girls and a little boy at the end. And I really love how he has 9 daughters. And then his 10th was a little boy. So, and he is one with the spiritual wisdom. He proclaims this as a hinge point in history and the beginning. And, you know, it's interesting because this, you know, a lot of money being spent. People, that's one of the biggest complaints that people have against temples. They say, oh, it's too expensive. The church could use that money, give that to the poor. So again, obvious temple theme. And in this case, preparing for the second coming. So before we get into like the nitty gritty of each of those, and I show you all that, I want to first show you just how this theme shows up in the April layer, so now they have a better feel for what this new theme is that we're looking at. So let me go to the gospel website really fast, and I will show you. Here we go. Okay, so you can see this is the April Liahona, and this article is bring enough. So it says, no matter what we consecrate to his work, our possessions, talents, time, faith, love, or how much we're able to contribute, the Savior can multiply and make use of every willing, heartfelt offering to kingdom and to do his work. So there you go. This is really cool. I loved how they had this visual. This is kind of this oil, this anointing, this woman with the box of ointment. And then
really quick, it's not showing up on the screen. I think you might have to when you screen share, you have to pick which window.
Oh, let's see. New share, maybe?
Yeah, just go down back down to screen share.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
Now, can you see it?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, there we go. So you can see here that we're on the Liahona, April Liahona, and you can see this woman. So we have the woman with the box of ointment. And then here we go, Mary, Martha's sister. So I love how it's kind of pulling out this theme of the anointing and Mary. And then if you go to, you go to the next one, find it. Go to how do I spend time? There we go, Mary and Martha. And it's making the point that, you know, we need to be careful about how we spend our time and how Mary teaches us. Are we trying to do too many things? Are we trying to like do it all ourselves? Or are we prioritizing this time of holiness and sitting at the feet of Christ and, you know, asking him and finding out what it is we're doing for him? So I thought that was really cool. And then there's also the theme of, if you go to this, Sisters in the Temple. So there you go. We have this kind of theme that goes along. It's kind of this couplet. It's like married to the theme, this anointing that goes along with our hinge point moment. So I thought that was really cool to see. And we'll go back to see if I can get the screen sharing back on. There we go. Okay. Can you see the presentation now?
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. Okay, so go to the next one. So you can see here, so when I looked up, so I Googled the Parshat Pekadeh, and I saw that this was taking place. President Nelson landed in Rome to dedicate the temple, and the Jews, they always read Parshat Pekadeh scriptures in 7 sections. So you can see there, where it says the full Kriya. So, and some Jews, they read portions triennially, so every 3 years. So without getting too complicated, just kind of take note of how this reading highlights this idea of a 3-year and 7-day cycle. And just in case that kind of rings a bell in your mind, a connection with the 2020 and the 2023 General Conference. So we have, again, the 3-year cycle and how Palm Sunday, Holy Week, is a 7-day cycle. Just let that simmer a little bit. So the Parshat Pekudei scriptures, as you can see, are Exodus chapters 38 to 40. And these scriptures describe the process of taking 7 days to set up the tabernacle. So what they do is they anoint everything. So it describes the anointing of everything inside with holy oil, including Aaron and his sons. And then on the 8th day, which is Nisan 9, it's consecrated. The Lord's presence enters in. All right, so Parshat Pekudei, it usually lands in March, but a wide variety of like which day it will land on. So anywhere in that generally is when it lands, but it really is a kind of a random day. But being that and that's in the month of the Hebrew month of Adar, but the consistent thing is that it always celebrates an event that originally occurred on Nisan 1 to 9. And the reason I say Nisan 1 to 9 is that there are actually two accounts. So it gets a little bit confusing. It's actually similar to the Mary of Bethany, where there's multiple accounts, kind of multiple dates. And some people see it as the same thing, but a lot of people see it as the same event. And so it's kind of interesting. So the Book of Chronicles, Biblical Antiquities, and rabbis, they generally read these accounts as describing the same event. So I figured we'll look at both. And in Exodus 40, it says, "On the first day of the first month shalt thou set up the tabernacle of the tent of the congregation, and thou shalt put therein the ark of the testimony and cover the ark with the veil. And thou shalt anoint the altar," and then it lists everything in the temple being anointed, "and thou shalt bring Aaron and his sons unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation and wash them with water. And thou shalt put upon Aaron the holy garments and anoint him and sanctify him, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office. And thou shalt bring his sons and clothe them with coats. And thou shalt anoint them as thou didst anoint their father, that they may minister unto me in the priest's office. For their anointing shall surely be an everlasting priesthood throughout their generations." So take note of that theme there, that everlasting priesthood blessings throughout the generations. So what better way to testify of this principle than holy day stacking, literal monuments in time throughout the generations. So, and then you look at Leviticus 9:1, and it says, "And it came to pass on the 8th day, Nisan 9, that Moses called Aaron and his sons and the elders of Israel, and Aaron lifted up his hand toward the people and blessed them. And Moses and Aaron went into the tabernacle of the congregation and came out and blessed the people, and the glory of the Lord appeared unto all the people. And there came a fire out from before the Lord and consumed upon the altar the burnt offering and the fat, which when all the people saw, they shouted and fell on their faces." So these Exodus scriptures I just read are a portion of the exact scriptures that the Jews read and study on this holy day of Parshat Pekudei. So kind of to just sum up what we just read, the tabernacle is completed, the washings, the anointings are done, and there Aaron lifts up his hands right before the visible glory of the Lord, which is also referred to as a cloud and fire, come into the tabernacle for all the people to witness. So there's this really interesting connection, anointing, preceding the dedication with uplifted hands, and all the people shouting. So if you watch, you know, the previous presentation, themes in that holy day stacking on Nisan 10. And how that ties into General Conference coming up in 2020. So
do you have those dates? Do you have what day it is today on the Hebrew calendar?
Like what date, like today's exact day, you mean?
Yeah, just like how close we are. Cause I don't know, are we in Nisan now or I'm not.
We are, let's see. I can look it up really fast to see what exact day today is.
Or here, I'll just look it up really quick.
Okay.
Give me one second. I'll switch to my screen. WebCal. Let's go to customize settings. Sorry, I'm just curious.
Yeah, look it up. I'm curious too.
Show Hebrew day. Wait. Get that. Great. Okay, so today is March the 27th. So today is the 5th of Nisan. So the first was last Thursday. And then sorry, what day is the I already forgot the name of it. That happens in Adar. What was that called?
The Parshat Pekudei.
Yeah, what day does that occur?
So Parshat Pekudei this year was on March 18th.
Okay, so it corresponded with like this.
Yes. Yes.
So this is where we're at,
Yeah.
everybody. We're on the 5th of Nisan today, and then Passover will be the first day of Passover is on the 15th of Nisan, which of course the day starts at sundown. So on our calendar it'd be at sundown on the 5th of Wednesday, or the 5th of April, which is a Wednesday, which will be a couple days, 3 days after conference. Okay. And conference is taking place this year on the 10th of Nisan and the 11th. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that that review, 'cause I know I
No
went over
problem.
that in the other
Yeah.
video, but that's a good point just to get to where we're at. And actually one of the kind of miracles, really cool thing that I'm going to share at the end has to do with what happened on Parshat on March 18th of this year. So we're kind of talking about, so these anointings, they're greasing the hinge points. And let's go ahead to the next. So there are even more common themes that are found. So next, let's compare a few of the common themes as they show up in Moses's, Jesus's day, and our day. So these stories and events, they're so similar. It's actually pretty amazing that they share the same dates and they also share such similar purposes. So let's look at the themes of women's wisdom, anointing, and the unified efforts of all. So kind of a Zion type theme. So the theme of women holding wisdom and spiritual intuition. This is actually another gem. This is part of that Exodus reading the on the day of Parshat Pekudei, and it says that in Exodus says, and all the women whose hearts stirred them up in wisdom spun goat's hair, and the rulers brought onyx stones and stones to be set for the ephod and for the breastplate, and spice and oil for the light and for the anointing oil and for the sweet incense. The children of Israel brought a willing offering unto the Lord, every man and woman whose heart made them willing to bring for all manner of work. And all these things are so building up and preparing for the coming of the presence of the Lord in the tabernacle. So we see women with wisdom. We'll see all the children of Israel bringing willing offerings, every man and woman who is choosing to participate. So again, that idea of Zikaron, are you choosing to participate? All these themes show up again in Jesus's day when Mary anoints Jesus. So Mary anointing Jesus right before Palm Sunday. So in John 12:1, it says, then Jesus 6 days before the Passover came to Bethany, so making it Nisan 9. There are not very many events in the scripture where the exact day is specified, except for holy days. You'll see when holy days occur in scriptures, it tells us the day. And so there's another hint as to how this particular event of Mary anointing is ties into holy day stacking. So the scriptural accounts of Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, who was raised from the grave, anointing Jesus' head and feet with oil, spikenard ointment, are recorded in Matthew 26:13. So we also see it in John 12:1-8, and then in Mark 4, chapter 14, 3-9. So we have a couple different accounts, and it actually does have a couple marks two different dates. So there's a little bit of that same kind of duality as with the Parshat Pekudei. So just like Parshat Pekudei anointing scriptures, there are these multiple accounts, and some view it as separate events, others view it as the same event. But in one of the accounts, she anoints Christ's head with oil. In another, she anoints his feet. And in John, it's revealed that the woman is Mary Bethany. So in Jesus's day, Mary Bethany anointed the Savior in Bethany just prior to his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And so Bruce R. McConkie, he said, as Samuel poured oil on the head of Saul and anointed him to be captain over the Lord's inheritance, and all Israel then marched at their king's word, as he also poured oil on David and anointed him in the midst of his brethren, so that the Spirit of the Lord came upon him from that day forward. And as Zadok took a horn of oil and anointed Solomon, and all the people said, God save King Solomon. So Mary of Bethany, in the home of Simon the leper, as guided by the Spirit, poured costly spikenard from her alabaster box upon the head of Jesus and also anointed his feet, so that the next day the 10,000s of Israel might acclaim him king and shout Hosanna to his name. So we see Jesus thus anointed and acclaimed, heading a triumphal procession into the holy city the next day.
And let me, can I say something really quick? No, sorry. I always, okay. So it, is Mary of Bethany different from Mary Magdalene, or is that the same
yes.
person?
Yes, it's a different Mary. So we have so many Marys, Mary, Mary, Mary. And Mary of Bethany is the sister of Martha. So you have this tight-knit group of Martha and Mary, who are sisters, and then Lazarus, their brother. And Jesus loves, they're his friends. They love to spend time together. This is Jesus's like safe, happy place.
Is it Mary Magdalene or is it Mary of Bethany that some believe may have been his wife?
Both.
Well, both.
It's actually both, but
so
more prominently people tend to think Mary Magdalene, but there are lines of thought thinking possibly, but this is all, nothing is like definitive, but just different lines of thinking that people have.
Well, the reason why I bring it up is because so what's interesting to think here, we know that when it comes to the second coming, there's this imagery used where Christ is the groom and the church is the bride. And here you have in Christ actual life, not metaphorically, him being the husband and her being the wife. And so there being a parallel between what's happening here with Mary of Bethany, if she was his wife, in her preparing him to be preparing him in the sense of anointing and stuff, preparing him to be the king, just like how the church right now would presumably be following kind of like a parallel, kind of like what you're drawing, us be the church being the wife, being the bride,
yeah,
and preparing for the king to come. Because when we think about Adam on Diamond, my understanding, I've tried to read everything that I can about it, but it seems like at Adam on Diamond, that's where Christ assumes the title or assumes the kingdom of the world. Yes, he's going to come officially to the entire world, but it seems that before that point with the church at Adam on Diamond, that's where he becomes king, or is first recognized as king of the world. Of course he's the king, but I'm talking about in the political sense. And so
right.
I just, it's a really interesting parallel. If she was his wife, the parallel between that story and what's happening in the last days. So anyway, I just had that thought.
Definitely. Yeah. No, there's so many interesting things to kind of think about and just ponder in regards to these stories and these parallels. It's never ending.
Yeah.
But yeah, I like that. I like that. So I really like how Bruce R. McConkie, the way he describes this story and the way he highlights how Mary in this way is acting in this prophetic manner. So she knows who he is, she knows what's coming, and pouring the oil upon a king, just like Samuel did to David. So she's understanding and she's acting in wisdom. And Jesus absolutely commends her bold actions by saying, "Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her." I know it's interesting that Jesus uses that super important word memorial, so zikaron, which is indicative of temple, covenant, holy day language. And then in the Joseph Smith translation of Mark 14:8, he actually changes it to be a chiasmus. And so chiasmus is a really strong way of highlighting the importance of something. And this is as being a very important moment in time. And so the center of that chiasmus, you can see, is anoint my body to the burying. So something to think about there.
Yeah.
So when Jesus responds to Mary Bethany's actions by saying, "This gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world." So at this point, Jesus is not just thinking about his burial at this point. He's seeing the whole thing. He's also looking well beyond that. So he knows that his death will be the subject of a message, the gospel, So this good news will bring about a future global harvest of sinners who will anoint and consecrate what they can to Christ and be saved. And that is this amazing action prediction couplet of Mary Bethany and Jesus. And this is still happening today. So ordinances beginning with the temple anointings are still occurring 2,000 years later. And he's telling all these Jews attending who would have had no idea what would happen in the future, that this gathering, that this message of the gospel about his death will be proclaimed for the benefit of the whole world, Jew and Gentile. And, you know, I see this happening all around me, and I love this miracle of how eventually the Jews and the Gentiles will see eye to eye. And just like a personal little miracle that I have is I actually have the opportunity to sing in the Lamb of God production in a Jewish synagogue this Easter Sunday, which, I mean, what kind of a miracle is that? It's amazing. My husband has the part of John the Beloved singing that solo. So it's going to be a really cool day. And I know that there are experiences like this, the whole Messianic Jew movement, there are things happening and it's fulfilling prophecy.
Is anyone going to record that? Is that something that you can put on your channel?
Not that I know of. I would have to get somebody to record it, but it's a good thought.
If you do, you should put it on your channel.
I should get some videos of that. And I can totally do it because there's not the no video. It's not in the chapel. It's going to be in the, so I don't know what their rules are for taking videos in the Jewish synagogue. So good thought.
Really quick, as we're talking about all this anointing and stuff and kingship, I don't know if you saw the video I did recently, but there was an article on Israel 365 where they've prepared the oil in Jerusalem to anoint King Charles because his coronation is coming up in May.
Yes.
And I can't help but to think that it's happening at a very interesting time. And it could be like a sign of things to come, or for all we know, maybe there's like some kind of thing where Christ is like, you know, before he becomes king, I will come and I will be king of the world or something like that. But I don't know what the connection would be, but it's just a weird thing to be happening right now.
Yes. Yeah. Very. Yeah. And all those other things and all your other videos about, definitely about all the oldest people passing away, the changing over the kingdoms. Definitely.
It's so weird.
Yeah, it's so crazy, so interesting. So it's interesting because in this there's this theme also of unity and every man, woman, and child being a part of these amazing events in history. So all these wonderful blessings that are meant for all play a part in this story. So if we really grasp that concept of Zikaron, we can liken these stories to ourselves, choose to participate, and then jump right onto the stage. And I think this is a crucial concept for setting the stage of Zion in the last days. I think this concept, it's a real faith builder and faith booster, and it can help us as we are heading into these new hinge point times. So the beginning of Parshat Pekudei, the Jews, they read Exodus 38, and there's this overall theme of, you know, a lot of, but you see this with all of them. So it actually starts out, they read the total amounts of gold, silver, and brass used in the construction of the tabernacle. So indicating it's a whole heck of a lot of money. It's a substantial cost to this endeavor. And then at the end of the synagogue service during the Haftarah, which is the final reading that they do in 1 Kings 7:51, it says, "So was ended all the work that King Solomon made for the house of the Lord. And Solomon brought in the things which David his father had dedicated, even the silver and the gold and the vessels to be put among the treasures of the house of the Lord." So later in Exodus, we also learn about the priestly garments to be worn, Moses anointing everything in preparation for the arrival of the presence of the Lord, signifying that everything is now ready for divine use. And then we see this, you know, theme of money in Jesus's day. So in different accounts, it says that some of the disciples murmured against Mary, and others it says that Judas did. So some murmured against Mary of Bethany for anointing Christ with the very expensive spikenard. So in Mark 14:4, it says, "And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, 'Why was this waste of the ointment made?' They accused, 'It might have been sold for more than 300 pence and have been given to the poor.'" So her bold and her generous actions are scorned by Judas and some others. And then on top of that, to let her hair down like that and wash his feet in front of everyone would have been seen as very inappropriate for a woman to do in that setting. So Mary anointed the feet of Jesus with costly ointment, and this 300 pence was most of an average year's wages. So this like giving her all, and then wiping his feet with her hair. So Judas protested, to which Jesus responded, "Let her alone, for she hath preserved this ointment until now, that she might anoint me in token of my burial." So this is like the spiritually tuned Mary she had prepared for this hour. And of course, you know, they're only surprised because they don't really realize that this doesn't make sense. Why is she doing this? Because they don't realize what is coming and how soon it's coming. And within the week, their Savior will have been crucified on the cross. They can understand the worth of the physical money, but not the greater context of the times they're witnessing, nor the spiritual significance and symbolism of the gift. So to have been Mary of Bethany in that moment with such keen eyes to see and ears to hear and understand that the Savior was trying his best to tell them, "I'm about to die for you." And then to understand that and act appropriately by ministering to him in this hour in preparation, it's really an amazing story. And it truly deserves, as Christ said, to be remembered throughout the whole world, wherever the gospel reached. That was quite the commendation, the prophetic pronouncement for Jesus himself to say about this moment of time. So then looking at our day, so do we have eyes to see how important the temple is? Is its value well beyond any amount of money? We know that one of the biggest complaints, I know Jared, you mentioned in one of your previous videos as well, it's too costly, critically. That money could have been for the poor. Use of the church's money. So some people will accuse that, but I think the story of Mary of Bethany completely validates the fact that these holy, most important things, it right above the value that is far above what we're thinking as far as physical money. There's more to it than just the logical thought there. So I'm not surprised that holy day stacking can be found around this theme. It really is a great way for God to honor that memorial in time, as he pronounced. So we have three anointing events that occur right before oiling the hinge points of our hinge point events. So we have the Parshat Pekodei and anointing the tabernacle. And that was right before the Shabbat Haggadah Passover time and before the presence of the Lord came. And then we have Mary anointing Jesus before Palm Sunday. And then we have the anointing before the Kirtland Temple dedication, before the Pentecost, and then Jesus coming to the temple. And then we have the Rome Temple dedication, which occurred before the 100th anniversary of the 2020 General Conference, with the 2023 parallel, which eventually will be leading into the Second Coming. So I just find that pretty interesting. I love that these holy day stockings, I really think, are parallel stockings. They're couplets. There you have the anointing. And I just kind of like the visual imagery of this oil preceding the way for hinge point, these doors of time to open and begin. Mm-hmm. And so exciting to think that we get the privilege of living in these times, and we get to see these amazing things as we read scripture. Think, oh, if I had been there, how awesome would that be to witness that, to experience that? But we also know from the scriptures that many, many, most people who were there experiencing it didn't realize exactly the significance. So I hope this makes us kind of really look into what in our day. So I'm not surprised. Again, it's a really great way for God to honor that memorial time. So I know we talked in the previous General Conference 2023 video that this upcoming General Conference has parallel holy day stacking. But just to kind of remind you guys, we won't be seeing a general conference on even just Palm Sunday until 2031. And we won't be seeing a Palm Sunday, Shabbat Haggadah, Nisan 10 general conference for many, many, many more years beyond that. So it's special. And we see that again with this upcoming one. So we've already seen that Palm Sunday and Mary of Bethany are big topics in the April Liahona. So it's really cool. We're witnessing history, historic gatherings, and historic events. So if you take a look here, if you were So if you were wondering, so Jared, you were wondering about the Parashat Pekahdeh parallel for this upcoming, like, you know, you're wondering when is the Parashat Pekahdeh this year and the parallel for this upcoming general conference. So I was curious too. So I looked it up and lo and behold, it was very interesting. So the Rome Temple anointing before general conference wasn't like, it wasn't the March and then April of the same year. It was the previous year Parashat Pekahdeh. So if we look at this upcoming general conference, or sorry, if we look at general conference 2020 and we go back a year, and we look at, sorry, I'm confusing. If we look at that and we see the Rome Temple as kind of the pre to general conference 2020, if we go back a year from 2023, so if we look back to last year's Parashat Pekahdeh in the same way, it was actually really cool what I found, which is that it was roots tech on that. So here we go. We have that whole temple thing happening on that day. So perfect timing. So that Parshat Pekahdeh is kind of parallel to the Rome Temple dedication, and I have roots tech, the church doing the roots tech. I mean, what are the odds of that? That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that is cool.
And then it was I thought, well, you know, this isn't like a direct parallel per se, but kind of looking at what happened on Parashat Pekahdeh for this year. So just a couple weeks ago, I actually didn't think to look it up until it had passed. So it was actually a couple days afterwards. And then I thought, I wonder like when it was, and I didn't realize that it had already passed. And I was, you know, looking around to see like, well, what did the church do on this day? And actually I couldn't find anything. But I, on a personal level, I just about like fainted and fell out of my seat because the day of Parshat Pekahdeh was actually my daughter's birthday. It just happened to land this year on my daughter's birthday, and her name is Mary, and I actually named her after Mary Bethany. So that was really
Jeez.
special. That was really cool. And it was also the day that I started writing about this and compiling it. Sorry, I don't know, I'm crying, but it was the day that I started like putting this all together. And so it was really cool to have that be on my little Mary Bethany's birthday and the day that I started this, and I had no idea. So it was like a personal day stacking as I was putting this together for all of you in preparation for this general conference. So I hope that in the true, this was like a true moment of memorial or Zikaron. I hope that as I just lay this research on what I found at the feet of my Savior, and I lay it at the feet of all of you, that it will help to oil the hinges in your hearts, and that your hearts will just open up and be excited for this general conference and realize how amazing these times are and how blessed we are to have modern day prophet and apostles, and that all these blessings that have been given throughout all generations of time are absolutely real and absolutely available to us if we'll just open our hearts to it and see, and God can manifest that to each of us in different ways. So that's basically kind of the end. That's kind of what I found. And thank you, Jared, for letting me come on again. And I hope people really get something out of this, and that you guys are all pumped up for General Conference this weekend. And I appreciate how on your channel you just lay out all the events that are happening all around, and we get to kind of sift through it and decide, oh, this might mean something, or no, I don't think that really matters. Or so it's this really great kind of adventure, and we get to kind of solve the mystery and put all the pieces of the puzzle together. So
Well, this was another really good piece of the puzzle. Let's see. Let me do the here. Can you stop the screen sharing just really quick? I just want to be able to go back to side by side. It's really exciting and clearly in my mind. Yeah, clearly something is happening with these two general conferences, and I think it plays into everything that you've said. Along with just everything else, just something really special and exciting is happening right now, it would seem. And I don't
definitely.
know what it is. I guess we'll just have to wait for another week and then we'll see what
Line
happens.
upon line. I think that's like the excitement of life, right? We reveal it line upon line. And even with this holy day stacking thing, I kind of get a hint of something and I think, oh, maybe you know, maybe there's something to this. And at first you think like, maybe, maybe not. And then just a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. But I think, yeah, as time goes on, we'll definitely look back and think, wow, that was amazing. God's perfect timing. He's got it all in his hands. So
yeah. And we've discussed
really
so
pretty
many
cool.
different possibilities of, you know, things that could happen or be announced during this conference. And, you know, from time to time, people will suggest, like, do you think that ever Christ could himself show up at conference? And of course he could, you know. I don't know what that would look like. There's all sorts of, like, theories as to how he would appear. You know, we know that he's going to come to New Jerusalem. There's going to be Adam on it, but it's like unclear exactly what those things look like. But if he was
right.
like, for example, to show up at General Conference, would he be clean shaven? I don't know. Like, I doubt that he's still doing the Nazarite vow. So I'm not sure he would still need to have long hair and a beard, but maybe he would. But, you know, whether it's him showing up or whether it's, I mean, that would cause quite a stir. The Salt Lake Tribune would be all over that and be like, oh, crazy church thinks that Jesus Christ is here.
Now that would be wild.
Yeah. Things would be in an uproar, I think, if that happened. But I don't know whether it's that or whether it's just like a special temple being announced, like making effort, putting, turning Independence into the new church headquarters or building a temple there, converting the visitor center into a temple. Sorry if you can hear all the yelling in the background. My autistic son is home
No,
and
no.
he's having a day. I don't know.
No, no
just,
worries. Yes.
It's just, I don't think that like you would be having all this like emphasis on Palm Sunday as well as planning like a special global choir for this particular conference.
Yeah,
it's all
yeah.
just like something's going on.
Well, I think if we, like, for me, as I look at it and I think, okay, all these holy days, these are all hinge points in time. And I think that's what I love about the story of Mary of Bethany, is you look at all the people and what would you do? How cool would that be to be living in that hinge point time and to have an idea of what exactly is coming, to realize that these special times are coming, to realize that there's a hastening of events. And again, that's where I come back to. This is why I'm starting my channel at Christian Fire Poppy, is just to encourage people to see that we are just getting, in my mind, I see it as we are just starting. We're just beginning the hastening of events. So it's not the time to be just business as usual. It's time to be prepared physically, temporally, spiritually, gather that spirit about you. Gather whatever supplies you think. If there are going to be hard times, be ready for that. And I think as you look at Holy Week and as you study it, and something cool that our family does that we do every Holy Week is we, and I always begin on Saturday, and we talk about the Mary of Bethany and the Palm Sunday, the entry, and we talk about all the events that happen on each day. And I have a box for each day, and we pull out little like symbols, little things, and then we have little gift scriptures and something to get the kids excited. And that there's, for each one of those days leading up to the eventual resurrection, there can be a parallel to us leading up to the second coming. And so we might see more than just Palm Sunday. If you look at the events in Holy Week, maybe we'll see events that stack events.
Yeah. And not only just like on our on these two calendars, both our Christian calendar, church calendar, Jewish calendar, but also kind of looking at the Islamic calendar and how like this year is interesting with that too, how that's stacking up with Passover and just all the like crazy instability right now in Israel. That's going to be my next video. Like right after we're done here, I'm going to launch into what happened over the weekend, because it took a step not in a good direction, like a good direction toward the final war, not a good direction in terms of like suffering and bloodshed, but that situation is devolving very quickly, and who knows how quickly things can happen. But it's an interesting year, to say the least.
Definitely for sure.
Well, I guess we'll wrap it up there. So thanks again, Jen, for sharing your insights, because it's given us more to think about, just more to highlight with this general conference and April 2020 general conference and other things. And you know,
yeah, well, thank you, Jared. I just
yeah.
speed up that you
Oh, sorry, it broke up for a minute. What did you say?
I said I'm happy to just whatever all that you put out on your videos as well. It just keeps me going. So it's a real process. I like it.
I'm glad to hear that. Thank you. All right, you guys. Well, if you haven't already, please make sure to subscribe. Also subscribe to Jen's channel. Like I said, it's going to be in the description below. It's going to be on my featured channels. It's called Christian Fire Poppy. So you can just search it as well. Like this video if you liked it. Leave your thoughts and opinions down in the comments below. Also make sure to share it. And I'll talk to you guys later.